Okay, here we go. Just for the case, in case someone have forgotten. Mixed signal design is very interesting because most of the design currently required are mixed signals. So you will see that there is no deposition, there is not something else I'll talk about, D2A converters, A to D converters, PLLs, all kinds of funny things, RF circuits, how do they interact. So this is a part of mixed signal. Okay. So we'll see there something differently. At that time I'll never say sputtering or any word of that. Okay. But today I'll say something more about depositions. We have done electron beam evaporation and normal resistive heatings, evaporations. Today we'll finish up by sputtering. Basically, I already said sputtering is a plasma ions which can be energized and they hit the target. Okay, the target is the material which you want to deposit and substrate is the where you want to deposit. So these ions actually hit the target and they somehow provide sufficient energy to stationary atoms, and when they come out there is something called momentum reversals, and those species of target, they get accelerated and actually go and hit the substrate and they lose their energy and therefore stick there. So that's the word sputter is. Okay. In most cases sputtering is done with a neutral gas like argon. But there is a possibility you can add some reactive gases, like you can add oxygen. Okay. So if you are sputtering and you also oxygen plasma, then you can oxidize something. Okay. So there is, this is called reactive sputtering. But most cases people do neutral ion sputtering. I think there is, that word will come soon and you will know why, where implant starts and where sputtering ends. There also actually we don't have that cathode to blow there, but there are also energetic ions. Here also there are energetic ions. The difference there and here is that there the acceleration is very high. You know, the column is so long and we accelerate to 300 keV. Here we will not like to go that kind of energies. Okay, so sputtering uses neutral gas plasma to sputter target material to be deposited. Essentially it displaces the atom and deposits on substrate. It normally requires moderate vacuum, 1 to 100 millitar, maybe sometimes 300 millitars. It is useful in deposition of metals, alloys, compounds, and even insulators. So that is the strength of sputtering. It can deposit anything actually. Mostly it is used for deposition of metals and alloys. Okay. Where do you think alloys are deposited? For example, these days you may require something called moly silicide or platinum silicide or titanium silicide. So these can be sputtered films. Okay. High end metals like tungsten only can be sputtered because tungsten is a 3300 degree melting temperature. Electron beam uses targets which are of that temperature, so you cannot actually evaporate that material. So essentially the materials which are high temperature melting points, they are normally sputtered. Okay. Okay. Please again, once all and all again, I have an argon gas which is neutral or inactive. Argon has an atomic number of 18 and sufficiently large in size therefore. Please remember, I keep saying when it is ionized, it will have equal number of electrons and neutrals. So plasmas are always neutrals. Okay. Thus we have argon plasma available for sputtering. So instead of any other gas, if I have a chamber in which I have argon, which is under vacuum to some extent, and I put DC bias against it, gas can be ionized. And if the distance between two plates is smaller, there will not be a positive glow, there will not be any Faraday's this, only one glow plus small dark space which we call sheath and the cathode. Okay. This is what the figure I have shown you. This is the kind of plasma you will get. Earlier I have shown you anode. Now I also showed you in this case, normally anodes are grounded and cathodes are given negative potentials. Since there are negative glow available here which has plasma, and some electrons are accelerated out of it towards anode, there is a small amount of voltage drop or dark space, you can say, even at the anode. That is called positive sheath. Okay. Now, or anode sheath. Now, these two things are, so in general, in a sputtering system, there is a small sheath at the cathode, a larger sheath at the cathode, and a smaller sheath at anode as well. Okay. Why, from where you can derive this? You have done an IV characteristics of a plasma system. If you have written down, I may just show you the figure which we had shown n times, but once again I will show you. Since anode is grounded, the potential at the anode end should be 0. Okay. Since it is negative, potential at the this end should be negative value, okay, which is the cathode voltage. Okay. I repeat, I am creating a plasma foregone by discharging it through a potential of minus Vc to ground, and I expect some cathode drop here which I call sheath potential in the dark space. Then there is a glow and there is a small anode sheath at the anode site. Is that okay? So the typical figure which we have been keeping showing you all the time at the voltage drop across cathode to anode, this is the minus cathode potential Vc. And as the dark space, you go towards plasma from cathode towards this, the potential start rising towards 0, because in the glow there is no much potential. But some potential is developed in the plasmas because electrons are leaving and ions are moving. So there is some moving charge which results in, equivalently saying, there is a some charge on this which gives some kind of potential. That is called plasma potential Vp. At the anode end, that's 0 because you have grounded it, which has a voltage increase. Okay, voltage in argon plasma is positive with reference to both cathode and anode. Now, argon ions, when accelerated towards cathode, where will they cross? Please remember, argon ions are in this and they are moving towards cathode, and they are getting accelerated because of the electric field which we applied. So these argons then will bombard cathode. Okay. So if I keep at the cathode a material which I want to deposit, let's say tungsten or any other material, so these argon ions will go and hit, that's called target. Cathode is normally a target at area. So if ions hit the target and they give their energy to them, and it so happens, and which is what the word is, a momentum reversal takes place, a stationary atom of target is removed from the target area and starts moving towards anode area, which is our, where we keep our substrates, okay, where we keep our substrates. Is it okay, figure? This figure, we have been drawing it n times, okay. This is why I actually discussed plasma in detail, because plasma is a, as I keep saying, 99% of the world is plasma and we don't talk about it. Okay, that's very funny. Okay. Right now it's a DC sputtering. But DC or RF also will behave similarly, isn't it, at high frequency. It can, same can be used in RF. We'll just show you the RF sputtering part. This is DC sputtering going on. DC has a problem which, since he has said it, the target has to have some metallic system, otherwise you can't put a bias there. In RF, you don't have to be that to be a metallic part, because RF will just move back and forth. So the advantage of RF is not just getting a fields, but it also allows you targets of non-metallic materials. Okay, that's the only difference. The argon ions accelerate through cathode sheath towards minus Vc potential. Argon ions are sufficient in kinetic energy, and now they bombard the cathode. In our case, cathode is the target plate and anode is the substrate. Then the target atoms are displaced from cathode, and due to process of what we call reversal of momentum, they move towards substrate and deposits there. More energy, energy momentum transfers can be discussed. But as I say, time not enough to really go through full theories. How reversal occurs can be proved. Okay. Just take it the target atoms, when released, they are still energy enough to come out and go towards anode. We define the term sputtering yield. That's the most important term which we use. It is essentially defined as number of atoms or molecules ejected from target per incident ions. So if one incident ion of, let's say, argon, how many or this comes out of the target is called sputter yield, okay, or sputtering yield. It has a, I think my notation is S, just check what Plummer has. I think he has not used S as the same name. Yes, that's what I say. Argon ions hit the target, give energy to them, okay, and the target atoms get excited and come out. Till they receive energy, how can they come out? Yeah, but the mean free paths are so that's the whole game. That mean free path for this is kept so high compared to this distance, so the collisions are minimal. I won't say there are no collisions. So there is scatter there as well, but that's a small scatter. Okay. I'll show you a figure how it occurs for your sake. Here is a figure. I knew he will ask, so I knew what figure I had to show you. So even if they are still under field, so they still both move, not in same direction. Actually, momentum reversal is possible because they are not going in vertical direction. Is it okay? Sputter yield is number of ejected atoms of target per incident ion. The sputtering yield does depend upon the mass of ions, okay, incidenting on target. So argon is heavier. So if you are lighter, it is unlikely to actually do much damage actually. It may not eject it actually. Also, at what energy they strike, okay, both energy as well as momentum is deciding how much kinetic energy it will have and how much it can transfer to stationary atoms. This is typically what you are asking. Argon may hit, may come down, may hit another one, but they again accelerate and there is some kind of a steady state achieved, some angle where this and some target atoms will come down. This is random process and can't be explained in just one. This is only a figure just to show you. This randomness allows you to momentum reversals. The intentionally this is probably given in Plummer's book, I don't realize but recollect. This is just to show you, even if there is a step somewhere, since the atoms are coming all angles, they will actually go what is called as conformal. It will climb on this. That is the biggest advantage this process allows, okay, because some will come somewhere and hit. If there is a step in the wafer, it will climb on that. Some atoms may come like this, some may come like this, some may. This is a random process. It's uniform over the time because this process is random, so it's average out correctly. As I say, I'm not doing a lot of theory on it. It's a, you know, there is another full book on sputtering, so you cannot carry on that in a day. What is the difficulty with DC sputtering is that you need cathode to be, and cathode anode to be metallic plates, because you need bias to be created there, so they both are conducting plates, okay. Particularly target has to be have metal, because otherwise it can't receive the voltage, okay. This is just a figure and this is not drawn to the scale or in, this is just to show how random processes can occur and can create reversals. Okay, here is something what is more relevant and which is DC sputterings are rarely used, except maybe we used to use in 1985-88. Now we also don't use. I don't know whether we use it also, but hopefully if we are using. Okay. This using system which is often used in the VLSI technology is RF sputtering. We have last time discussed the area ratios, smaller area compared to this. Please recollect what I did say. If cathode area is A1, cathode anode area is A2, we have two possibilities. Either areas are same or cathode is smaller than anode, which is two possibilities we can create. I apply to a cathode through a matching network. Why you need a matching network? Because matching the impedance. So what kind of matching network it will be? LC, normally a LC with variable resistor there, okay, which is not really a resistor but a device which provides you the resistor. Matching network system costs 6 lakhs in market. So you can see it cannot be just wired LNC, okay. So just to tell you, okay. And in our lab, if still existing old lab, one of my students has designed and fabricated our matching network, which we also spent 2.5 lakhs, but at least cheaper than the 6 lakhs. So we have a generator which essentially is going to the this. Then we have this is called susceptor or substrate holder, which is normally heated, okay, around 300 degrees centigrade. And then on this substrate, this you keep your wafers, whichever number of wafers this is a circular disc, okay, in which you can keep number of wafers. Larger the surface area you have, larger number of wafers you can keep. This is grounded, so is the chamber is grounded, okay. The chamber is also of metallic, this, so both chamber as well as substrate holder is grounded, which acts like an anode. There is a gas inlet, there is a vacuum. What do we do? First we evacuate everything. We actually evacuate to the pressure of how much it should be, as low vacuum, as low pressure or as high vacuum possible, to avoid oxygen or any other species which may interact, okay. So 10 to power minus 6 star is the minimum you should first go, or if better pumps available, even minus 9 you should go. But generally larger the vacuum requirements, costlier is the system. But if your films are not that great, you don't put that money. So between these two, as we have discussed, if the areas are equal, the potential at both sheets will be some kind of zero at both ends, and there will be a plasma potential Vp. In case the area of cathode is smaller than area of this, it will have a more drops, because it will be, why it will be have more drop? Because the ion density will increase. Is that point clear? Area reduction means ion density will increase. And larger the ion density, more will be dropped across J sigma E, okay. So it happens that if I push smaller area, I am actually increasing the potential at that end. So it will be like earlier one, DC kind, and it will be something. But then the net potential is applied average of RF plus DC, which we have through matching. So average is same as what it was. Area under the curves are same. So more potential at the cathode, but lesser plasma potentials. Okay. The ratio of V1 and V2 potential here and here, this is V1, V2, is essentially the area ratio, and M is some factor which people believe it is around 1 to 2. Many people take it 2, it is area squared. But it's not true, you have to figure out from different film measurements and find what is the ratio of A1, A2, which is the ratio of V1, V2. Okay. Why V1, V2 ratio I am interested in? Because how much is the plasma potential and how much is the cathode potential will decide the acceleration of ions. How many available and how much acceleration I can give will decide by Vc and Vp. So that adjustment I will have to do for a given species which I want to evaporate or this. So what is the advantage of RF system compared to DC? I am not saying each cathode has to be metal. I can put an insulator there. Back plate I may put metal, but I am not, because it both side RF is moving plus and minus, so it doesn't really matter too much, and therefore even insulators can be sputtered in the film RF systems. Insulator has a problem like SiO2. So when the ions, when it will hit it, it should be less than the binding, and I mean it should not be larger than the binding energy of SiO2. Otherwise silicon and oxygen will separate, okay. And this oxygen ions may go back to the silicon upper target and rather going to the below target. So the catch is that how much energy in reactive sputtering you should have, which will allow you to do silicon dioxide, silicon nitride deposition. So there is a, every process has a different methods, and so much pressure and so much V1, V2 is adjusted. Okay. The advantage of all these sputtering is conformal sputtering. What is conformal? The shape of the surface, it will pick up all the shape of the surface. If it is step, it will step. It will go down, it will go down. Okay. This figure is probably available in every book, whichever book you have seen or not seen. So basically two things I am saying, a sputtering helps you, DC sputtering can sputter metals, even high rare earth metals like titanium, platinum, high noble metals, they can also be sputtered, and other rare earth like molybdenum, tungsten, they also can be sputtered. Evaporation cannot do that because there they are used as a source or basket where you heat the material. So never use these for other sputtering is the only possibility. What is the else possibility could be? If I don't want to do sputtering, the problem, what do you expect problem in sputtering? Since there are too many electrons and ions are going and their energies you are going to adjust, there will be some damage on the wafer is going to come, okay. And this damage has to be annealed again. So instead of trying to anneal the damage, you can reduce the damage by another process which we will now do is chemical vapor deposition. So there we will not use physical bombardments, okay. Okay, so this is advantage of RF system is it's conformal and even dielectrics can be sputtered. But before we go to CVD, here is a model for simple model for sputtering. This model is not the best model, but you can, one can use it to find the thickness of the film deposited. What is our ultimate aim in the model? I want after so much time how much is the film thickness I got, because that is the decision given by the circuit people. I want thickness of metal line to be so much because I am expecting R to be per unit length so much, okay, interconnect. So I am told by them, so I must provide them that much thickness. Is that clear why designers actually just say I want this and then how much we play for? Okay. Okay, a very basic model of sputtering is provided. We already said sputter yield is the ejected atoms per incident ion, and it is found that S is equal to alpha times, not proportional, alpha times e to the power half minus e to the power th to the power half, where e is the incident ion energy and has a mass m1 and maybe z, atomic number z1, which, what is for this incident means what? In our case argon, so argon has atomic number of 18, mass much larger, typically 32, 38, then ETH is the threshold energy required for dislodging a target atom. So unless E exceeds that, atom cannot be displaced, and also gives the momentum reversals. And alpha is a proportionality coefficient, and it has been found that this is a function of target atom atomic number, the atomic number of incident ion gas atoms, and also what we call as sublimation energy, or it is also called binding energy, substrate binding energy, SBE. Alpha is a proportionality constant, which is a function of target atom atomic number of incident gas atoms, and also its sublimation energy, which is also called the binding energy. So we'll get a formula for alpha. So I will be able to find alpha. I know what E I am incidenting, and if I can find ETH, then what should I do? I must adjust E so that for a given species and given substrate gases, one be able to get some yield of your choice. What is yield to do with it? How much ideal yield it will be? One. One is should give one, or even more if possible. Ek mana chhe nikle. That is even gain, but that's very difficult. Okay. So we are trying to see how much number of atoms I can get on the substrate per unit time, per unit area, flux as we call, and for a given time and mass we are using, we can find how much film thickness we have. So that's the ultimate purpose of, so I must first find what should be ETH, okay, And once I know ETH, and if I know alpha, I know for a given yield which is decided by the current requirements or the sputter requirement, I will be able to adjust my E. Is that correct? So how E is adjusted for given S, which decide the thickness. Okay. Now without going into kinetics, I just wrote down final answers for it. If M2 is the atomic mass of the target and maximum energy transferred to it by incident energetic ion, E energy is the ion and mass of that ion is M1, that is argon in our case. This is not C. It can be found by writing the conservation of energy momentums. One can derive this expression. E maximum which is transferred to stationary atom is 4m1 m2 upon m1 plus m2 square into E, E which is incident ion energy. The maximum E max which you can achieve is called ED, or what is called a displacement energy, and that is also, we can say, in normal case this ED should be same as the threshold energy for removal of atoms. So I must find ED from this. I know M1, M2, I know incident energy, so I know ED, and if that ED, I use that as a thermal energy, and if E is larger than this, only then we can say some sputtering will take place. Generally, this energy transfers in the range of 10 to 35 eV. Please remember, ED is, this is the maximum transferred energy and not ED. ED is the stationary atom energy which it can pick up if I hit with Emax. Okay. After exchange, Emax is the available energy there, and ED is the one which is required to take the displacement of atom out of the target, which essentially is threshold energy. So ED is typically found to be 10 to 35 eV. Incident ion will be higher energy, and normally ED will be smaller, and only then sputtering can take place. Please remember, unless hit it and energy is received by a stationary atom, it can't come out. So it must get transferred enough that it ejects out. Okay. So this, as I say, I just write down this right now because lot of theory involved and I have no time to explain now. I just thought I will give you the expression, which this expression you should know. This energy which I may give you, what is the typical threshold energy used, and why I am doing it. I want to finally get interested in what? Thickness of the film. So I will try to relate that S some way. Is that okay? Alpha can be derived as 5.2 by u Zt upon Zt to the power 2 by 3 Zx to the power 2 by 3 to the whole power 3 by 4 Zx upon Zx plus Zt to the power 0.7. This is some kind of a function derived for alpha for incident ion hitting the target, stationary targets. Please remember, in this analysis all internal energies are used in EV per mole. So 1 kilocalories per mole is essentially 0.0434 EV per mole. Since all this formula has been derived using EV per mole, so even if your actual this is kilocalories per mole, you must first convert it into equivalent of 0.0434 EV mole ratio. All incident ion energies and ETH are expressed in kilo electron volts. Okay. The cathode voltage, for example 100 volt, is essentially saying has an ion energy of 0.1 keV. Is that Q into E? So what's called keV. For a case of tungsten, using the alpha value for tungsten and argon, I have figured out at 100 volts, S is typically 0.2 atoms per ions. You can find out yourself. I have given you all values, you can calculate S. This is the value which I calculated, roughly 0.19 something it came. So I have just said 0.2 atoms per ion. So one incident ion, that is 5 incident ion will eject equivalent of one target atom. So what is the rate of sputtering if S is the yield? if ions, number of ions per unit area per unit time is J, which you are monitoring across the circuit, which is why matching network you can actually monitor the current. So it's a current density is J ion. So what is the sputtering rate? J into S divided by Q, okay, divided by Q, okay. Because J has Q terms, so just divide by Q, okay. Is that okay? Point clear to you? This of course is not given anywhere, this is my just calculation from the formulas which I had. Just try yourself, put some values. I used argon and tungsten. Okay, tungsten has a weight of 74, okay. Atomic number is even, I don't remember, 32 or 31 something. I have taken from a table, so you can also, that data I will give you. So actually I had to go and look for these values. So I had to ask you, means I'll have to first search that new atom, uska data mujhe hi nikalna padega, but I will do that. The rate of sputtering is called RSP, is S times J ion by Q. Unit of RSP is number of atoms sputtered per unit area per unit time. And RSP is related to growth rate, which is what you are looking for, is G time, G is the growth rate, rho is the density, atomic density, Avogadro number, atomic weight M. This we did some way in implantation, okay. So it is similar expressions are obtained for this. Now the question asked by this, if your incident ion energy is much larger than threshold energy, much larger, then ions will get inside, okay, and not be able to, even if they displace, since the depth is higher, they will sit inside. So they will not get ejected. Is that clear to you? If I have very large incident energy, the ions will actually go deeper to lose the energy, and the momentum reversal may not allow atoms to come from the surface, or you can say there will be some, but that yield will be very small, and I am looking for sufficient yield of atoms to come back, and therefore larger energies are used only in implantation, smaller energies are used in sputtering. So basic process is similar, only thing is if you hit too far it will go inside, and then the atoms coming out may not transfer energy enough to come out of the substrate, I mean target itself, it may sit inside. It may, what we call, damage the upper layer, but nothing will come out. That's what has happened in implantation. The upper layer gets all damaged, atoms keep moving from the sides, but nothing comes out, no silicon deposition takes place, okay. That's exactly the difference between sputtering and implantations. Is that clear to you? So don't get too different, they are similar process, and similar formulas have been used to derive both cases, okay. So this essentially we did, one of the method of deposition is physical vapor. Why it was called physical? Because I am energizing and kinetic energy is provided by me, and if they hit somewhere, or they evaporate with another kinetic energy vapors and hit somewhere. So physical vapor depositions are evaporations using filaments, using electron beams, or using sputtering. Before we, of course, we go to the etching part later, maybe next week, last class. Can you think the same sputter unit can be used as an etcher? What is being deposited is the target, this. So if you change the one upper to lower, lower to upper, it will become a RF etcher, okay. Exactly what they do, okay. Okay, so this finishes PVD. Now we start with the next possible method of deposition, which is called chemical vapor depositions. Again, there are many, many features of CVDs, which this course should have talked about, but will not be able to talk about. So some gist only will now be provided, okay. I may be actually recording the rest part some other time and will put it into my course, but for your class of 3 hours, three and a half hour, whatever it is, I will not be able to do a lot of justice to lot of thermodynamics which is involved in this. Okay, I'll just mention what is the thermodynamics involved. There are number of ways CVDs are, number of systems or number of methods available for CVD. One is called atmospheric pressure CVD, which is popularly known as APCVD. Then there is a low pressure CVD, which is LPCVD. Then there are also, of course, they are not, these and these are similar but not exact. There is the atmospheric pressure low temperature CVDs, okay, particularly used for dope glasses. Then there is a plasma enhanced CVD. Then there is a very popular name, atomic layer depositions. Okay. Essentially, I may tell you, ALDs are used for textured depositions, and will some other time this word will be explained. MBE molecular beam CVD, actually it's not called CVD, it's MBE, is deposition is going on. Molecular beam epitaxy, as the word, we'll discuss this word epitaxy here as well, and we'll see that this is the best possible deposition system, extremely costly. These days Samir has one for, and it is only for one species. If you are working on gallium arsenide, you have that MBE machine is only dedicated to gallium arsenide. Nitride, you have another machine, and 10 crore is the cost as of now. So it's a huge money. Unless you are really working on LEDs, don't buy any such systems. Okay, so these are possible CVD techniques. We'll not go into all of them, but at least briefly to expose to all. What films we need in VLSI? We need dielectric films of SiO2, silicon nitride, hafnium oxide, and many such high K materials. Okay, like lanthanum oxide, gallium oxide, many polysilicon films. Self-aligned gate and small interconnects. Okay, these are requirement for polyfilms. Of course, now pure polyfilms are rarely used. They are used as silicides with some material, okay, metal, molybdenum, or even titanium. Where do you think polyfilms other than CV, MOS transistors are used? Solar cell, na? Abhi ek bola na? LCDs. LEDs, what else? There is a driver for the small displays, for LCD display. There is a circuit which is used out of thin film transistors. All thin film transistors are made out of polysilicon. Okay. There are 25 things which polysilicon can do. A poly plant, 200 million tons, 2 million tons a year may cost you $200 million. And unless that much 2 tons of poly is used by us, there is no point in putting a plant. Okay, and therefore in the world there are 3 or 4 companies which manufacture silicon, polysilicon, and this. One is Wacker Chemie from Germany, the other is Monsanto from US, Dow Corning from this, and then there is one Tagano or something in Japan. Okay, thermal bath. Okay, so further we also need atmospheric CVD for epitaxial films. Now the word epitaxy will come back again later. EP stands for as it is. Okay, tax means texture. So if I have a silicon wafer and I want to deposit silicon crystalline wafer as it is, because lower was crystalline wafer, I want to deposit a layer of crystalline silicon, then it is called epitaxy or epitaxial layer. That process is also atmospheric pressure, and maybe quickly we'll talk about how they do that. How much is your thermal budget and the quality of film desired decides the choice of process. We have seen just now the process which you have gone through. We have used titanium, you have used tantalum, you have used tungsten, we have used poly, we have used nitrides, we have used, and of course high K we did not show, but that is also replacing a SiO2 gate. So everywhere we will require one or the other CVD to go through. And not all processes will be from one kind of CVD. Okay, at one time I'll use one kind of CVD, for the other time I'll use other kind of CVD, and in some cases I may use sputtering, okay, which I find is cheaper. Like the applied material has sputter etch, they are using etching using sputtering. Okay, but they also can use it as a depositing system, metal depositions. Okay, so they are same system. Of course, there are ports separated so that no contamination, but the system is same. Have you been any time to that lab space? Try yourself, if not, force yourself through someone. Okay. Just for the heck of it, before we start one of the process or the other, there is some comparison people do, which I also did. We have three kinds of CVD compared: AP-CVD, LP-CVD and P-CVD, and there are certain advantages, there are certain disadvantages. Again, when I come to the figures, I will re-give you some more data there. But just for the heck of it, I stroll. The AP-CVD requires simpler reactor. It is a very fast depositing system and can be operated at low temperatures. The disadvantage is poor step coverage. There is a particle contamination possible, and it has a very comparatively lower throughput rate. What is lower throughput rate? Number of wafers per unit time, how many come out is the throughput rate. Okay, so it has much lower throughput rate. Of course, we will show you one conveyor belt system where throughput is increased, but not so great. The way gases are, amount of gas which I pass in AP-CVD is in liters, tens of liters. So the growth rate is very high. If I don't do it, then what I will show you, a boundary layer cannot be formed. That is, laminar flow is not maintained. So I want a laminar flow. So I will maintain my gas pressures as well as, I mean, atmospheric pressure, water gas amount, so that laminar is maintained. I will show you this now. So it is very fast depositions. Throughput is the number of wafers per unit time which susceptor can hold. So there are 16 wafers, so at best in one run 16 will come out. Okay, that is throughput. The deposition rate only decides how thick the films I can, how fast I can deposit a given thickness. Okay. So that is fast, whereas throughput is from the system how many wafers come out per minute, per hour, whatever is the rate. So if you have a susceptor which can hold 100 wafers, it is a throughput of 100, okay, per say 30 minute or whatever. But any flat system, you know, you have a 8 inch dia wafers, so how many wafers you can really keep? 6, 8 on a big susceptor. But if you stack like this, you can stack 200. Okay. So normally atmospheric CVD have a flat requirements, and LP-CVD all are vertical requirements, and therefore they have a lower throughputs. They can be used in doped and undoped oxide. These are called low temperature oxides. Okay. And also, of course, I forgot major and EP. But then it is not low temperature. Then it is very high temperature, 1100 degree. LP-CVD, which is low pressure CVD, it has an excellent purity, very good uniformity, very good coverage and very large throughputs. Okay. The disadvantage is it is high temperature process relatively, and low deposition rates, and it can do almost everything. Okay. Yeah, that for polysilicon depends on what you are growing. It can grow anything. Amorphous can be grown at 400, 300. Poly will be at least 600 to 900, which is not. Atmospheric pressure you can do at 400. LTO, low temperature oxides. If the application of AP-CVD is only deposition of doped glasses, passivation as we call, and it is 400 degree depositions. Okay. But EP, as I said, if you are doing AP-CVD epitaxial growths, then it is 1100. That is a very high temperature because you want crystallinity. Okay. Is that okay? Poly has to be little larger temperature because you want some crystallinity to attain. Is that clear? Nothing else can create crystallinity except the thermal energy. So you have to provide that. You may do it either by furnace, by RTO, RTP or whatever process, but energy will have to, by lasers, there are methods of doing halogen lamps, all kinds of processing can be done, but energy should be thermal for crystallization, no other way. Atoms must settle. Okay. Okay. There is a soil gel method, it can go very thick films, but they are quantity is so poor that they can't make any cell. If you make a solar cell out of such solgels, solution gel as they call, it may have less than a 0.05% solar cell. You may have a film. So it depends on the application and what kind of purity you are looking. That much thickness and that quality has to be attained. So process is decided where is your application. Is that okay? There are cheaper processes available. Now thin film depositions which we are trying for silicon is a polysilicon film. Just deposit, keep doing on a roller. Okay. So large area solar cell with thin films, 3%, 5% efficiency. So it depends, as I keep telling you, all processes are available. Your application and your quality of requirement should decide. Yadi mask aisa hai, to ye sab jagah same thickness chalega. Since it's a gas, it doesn't have to be hit by anything. It just finds the slope wherever it climbs on that. So thickness is roughly uniform even if you have steps. Okay. If it is a large upper area, uske upar bada aata hai. We have shown you, we have to do a CMP just because the area, the surface is not planar. Okay. So a non-planar surface will create non-planar depositions. There is nothing we can do. The last is of course the PECVD, which is low temperature fast deposition system. It has excellent step coverage. Actually it is doing at pressures which is slightly better than LPCVD. There is a problem of chemical and particle contaminations, which is like APCVD. You can do low temperature insulator depositions over metals, which is many times required in interconnects where this is used. There are 7 layers of interconnects I am creating, and in between I need a low dielectric materials, okay, and these are normally deposited by plasma enhanced CVDs. And also finally, because you don't want to disturb the wafer ready for circuit, so the passivating silicon nitride is normally done by PECVD or sometimes using low temperature atmospheric pressure CVD. Because 300 degrees, the uppermost temperature will be given to me. Okay. This can be done at 100 to 300. This can be done up to 350, 400. Yes, both have. APCVD doesn't have. Because gas goes like this. I'll show you the figures now. See, anything in which it's a, of course the word is coming, which is only temperature dependent, then it will cover every area. If it is mass dependent, how much gas reaches, then it depends on if you have to go in, all mass cannot go in. Okay. So there is an issue, whenever there is a mass transfers, there will be always less step coverage. If there is a temperature reaction limited, then everywhere everything can go. Here is what I am saying, all that said. A typical deposition rate, which is called Vy, of a CVD process, at its temperature dependence is shown here. Sometimes of course instead of one, this I may actually give you 1000 by T. Okay. All temperatures are measured in kelvins, please remember, unless specified. If I give you 27 degrees centigrade, make it 300 degrees Kelvin. So if I plot 1000 by T versus, so 1000 by T means T which side increasing? T increasing on this side. Okay. So if one, it is found that at higher temperatures somewhere, the process of deposition is normally controlled by mass transfers, and relatively lower temperatures, relatively not very low, it is limited by what we call as reaction rate limited. This names do you get somewhere from Grödel model? Okay, same. Deposition rate, ln is log, okay you forget about because it's a log scale, so it's a Vy. Vy is the deposition rate. Okay, deposition rate, Vy. The Y word was used because of excess people are using XY, so it is just a matter of Y is not necessary because they will show you some directions, so I also use the same method. Okay, so is that clear? So the point which I am trying to create is the following. So before I go to the actual AP-CVD and others, typical CVD reactions can be shown in this figure, okay, for AP-CVD in specific. For AP-CVD system, or maybe I'll first show you AP-CVD so that you'll appreciate what I'm talking. This figure has been taken from Do Corning's paper. Okay, it's a copyright. This equipment is a copyright of Do Corning. Why Do Corning became very unfamous in India? Why Do Chemical became so bad? Because they took over Union Carbide, which created all problems in Bhopal. Okay. Okay. So here is a typical AP-CVD system. We'll show you some more figures on that. There is a heater here, over which wafers are kept vertical. Then there is a nitrogen gas, process gas, hydrogen gas, or nitrogen gas, many gases. There is exhaust, and this is little higher throughput machine. That's a standard machine. What is this circle shown here? Pulleys and say conveyor belt. So it is in the chamber. So wafers come, they deposit, go down, keep going through this lower side. So this is slightly higher input. This is of course required in EP, and I'll come back to it later. What are typical steps in AP-CVD? Reactant reaches deposition region where substrate are horizontally kept. Is that clear? The first thing is, in AP-CVD, wafers are kept horizontal. From the ambient gas stream, the reactants diffuse through boundary layer, and that is something weird which earlier we discussed in crystal growth. There is a stagnant layer which is called boundary layer, okay, which is the region which is between the gas stream and the wafer. There is a region where nothing is actually happening. Or we say velocity is balanced. The stream velocity with the surface velocities are balanced. Okay, is that okay? First is, they come on, the wafers are kept horizontal. The gases come and moves over them. Okay, and the way it is, and that is figure we'll draw a little later. There is a boundary layer between the gas stream and the wafer. So any reaction has to take place, and that is where that figure will be better off, okay, before I come back. Here is the continuous gas flow. This is your substrate. This layer of atoms is called boundary layer. They don't move very much, okay. So new species have to actually diffuse through this gas stream molecules or atoms actually then to deposit. Is that clear? There is a boundary layer of gas which is, oh, because of the pressure to adjust and stream velocity to adjust, there is a layer above this which is constant. Typically, this is a function of gas stream velocity, but it is typically constant in its thickness generally. Okay. So all the diffusion, what is the reaction I am talking for this silicon depositions or polysilicon? Silane is the gas I used. Which gas? Silane. I oxidize it with oxygen to create SiO2, and gas H2 is exhausted. Okay. This SiO2 also has another this. If you want, then SiH4 plus SiH2 gas, this is called disilane. H2 gas may create H2 and polysilicon. Okay, this is at low temperature, that is at high temperature. This is at high temperature, this is at low temperature. Thermodynamics is avoided. I just gave the final result for you. Okay. So this is continuous gas flow. There is a boundary layer. Reactant atoms go through this and then start settling there. Now when they settle, there are many things. Whenever atom sits somewhere here, it should have sticking. So what is the sticking related to? One is called surface binding energy. Okay. The other is, it should be able to move ahead because the next atom has to come. It's called volume energy. these two, when it's called nucleation sites, so when first it should create nucleation sites, so it must have enough surface binding energy so that atom can sit there, and it should move, so it should have some energy which should overcome the volume energy, and then only they will move. So there are few energies involved which thermodynamically found how much is available for each gas stream and each gas atoms. Okay. Now this process which I was discussing just now is the reactor. The reactants are then absorbed at the wafer. This word absorption and adsorption is slightly different. What is the difference? Adsorption is also at the surface. Where is it then? No, no, it's called inside the surface. It's still on the surface, but inside the surface. Addition and subtraction is the word used in absorbed and adsorbed. Okay. Okay. The reactants are then adsorbed at the wafer. Surface reactions occur. Here the chemical reactions take place, deposition occurs conformally. What is conformally? Step ho, step parvi. Why? Because sites are where, wherever it finds sites, only there it can deposit. So, and also it will be simultaneously, something will be emitted, not all will be sticking there, some will come out, and some will also redeposit. Okay. So there is some kind of equilibrium will be attained in the system. Unreacted reactants and the byproducts are dissolved. Dissolved means they leave the surface. Okay. They transport through the boundary layer and are exhausted out of the system. We can have kinetics of such depositions similar to Grody model. I will just do this today and then maybe. I have a boundary layer, some gas stream is coming and reacting. Same thing. Only difference in Grodilma, there was a thickness of oxide through which oxidant was diffusing. There is nothing called such in between. Okay. Only boundary layer which is also gas. Okay. So that's the only difference. Is that correct? There is no intermediate oxide layer. So how many fluxes will be there? Two. There was third flux, there is not existing. Just note down and then I'll show you the mass for the day. We'll finish today for that. Unreacted reactants and byproducts, all gases are not reacting, so the some part will just go away. Okay. Some byproducts like hydrogen. Okay. If I use silicon tetrachloride, what will be the byproduct? HCl. So there will be always a byproduct of the system. Okay, is that fine? We assume normally that the boundary layer is fixed. Okay, but it can be a function and can be solved also. But right now I say delta x, but then I say it's delta. But as such, delta x is not uniform. Okay, is that okay to all of you? Is that okay? So here is that simple kinetics which we do. We have a gas stream, we have a silicon substrate. Cg is the gas stream concentration and Cs is the corresponding gas stream concentration, gas concentration at the surface. And this delta x, or delta as such I am going to use constant later, is the boundary layer thickness. So anything which is coming from here has to go through the boundary. And not all will reach because there will be diffusivity involved there. Okay. So Cg to Cs, and from here whatever flux available will react with silicon or deposit on silicon to create the new atomic layer. Okay. So we have two fluxes to offer, the diffusion flux of reactant to the wafer. This process is mass transfer limit. Why it is called mass transfer? Available gas concentration is proportional to partial pressure. So how much is available is decided by the partial pressure. Henry's law, thoda padho fir se. So ye Cg aaya, ye F1 flux hai. Then F2 is the flux which is reacting or depositing system, okay, which is surface reaction. Is that clear? This SI creation there from SI H4 or SiCl4 acts where? At the site. If you take away wafer, the reaction can take also in the gas stream sometimes, and we must avoid that. It should always occur at surface. Okay. So we have two fluxes to matter. We say F1, which is mass transfer limited, Hg is called mass transfer coefficient, units of centimeter per second. F1 is Hg times Cg minus Cs, and F2 is reaction rate constant Ks times available concentration Cs, and in steady state F is equal to F1 equal to F2. Same as Grödel-Mahr, what is the difference there? There is no oxide layer where further third flux is occurring. Okay. If F1 is equal to F2, these two are equal. Okay. Steady state, both fluxes must match. Okay. Okay. Maths, trivial maths. So if I equate them and collect the terms, I can write Cs is equal to Hg upon Hg plus Ks into Cg, or 1 upon 1 plus Ks by Hg into Cs, or in a this 1 plus Ks by Hg to the power minus 1 into Cg. So I have now related Cs and Cg through what terms? Mass transfer coefficient and reaction rate constant. The growth rate, as we did there, dx by dt is similar here, thickness grown or deposition rate. Growth and deposition are slightly used in same fashion, but they are different. There is no growth, that is no silicon is consumed here. Okay. But assume that deposition and growth, I am talking in same terms, okay, which is flux divided by number of available atoms which are incorporated on surface. Then Vy, I use F from here, okay. One of this Ks, Ks times Cs is flux. So Ks times Cs is flux divided by N, okay. Now there is another term which we use in actual this. There is a Ct denotes the concentration of all molecules in the gas phase in total chambers, okay. Cg is the fraction of Ct which is available for diffusion. Is that clear? Pure gas stream mein Ct concentration, usme se kuch hi react karne niche aate hain. That is Cg. So iska ratio, how much is available and how much is going down, is called mole fraction. Ideal gas law fir se padho. Thode chemistry hai isme. Please remember, Ct is in the whole system. And Cg is where actually reaction is going to take, how much is coming in, okay. So this is called mole fraction Y, which is Cg divided by Ct. Why I am interested in this? Ct is proportional to what? The actual pressure with which gas will be introduced. How many liters per second and what pressure? I know how much gas I am pushing it. This is measurable quantity. Ct is measurable quantity, okay. Is that point clear? If I know Ct and I know why, how much is the reaction I can derive, how much is the mole fraction I am having, then I will be able to correlate the external gas flows with the growths. Okay. Okay. Is it okay? Is that okay? So Y is Cg by Ct, but we know by partial pressure law, mass law, this is proportional to Pg by Pt. Pg is, let's say if I am using trichlorosilane as the gas, and the reaction which I used to show this is for epitaxial growth, silicon tetrachloride plus 2H2 at high temperatures reduces to, reacts to give silicon plus HCl. And whether this reaction will be favored or silicon may react back with HCl and give me silicon tetrachloride is decided by thermodynamics, okay. At delta G is positive or negative, delta S is the change in entropy at temperature T, and delta H is the enthalpy. If this is this, if positive, this will be forward reaction. If it is minus, it is a reverse reaction, okay. So you must adjust your T and the concentration such that forward reaction is favored. Okay, so if I now see y, which is proportional to Pg by Pt, then I say Vy is Ks Hg upon Ks plus Hg Ct by n into y. Okay. Now there are two possibilities. This is the growth rate or deposition rate. What is this? One of Ks Hg by Ks plus Hg means what is essentially I am talking is 1 upon Ks plus 1 upon Hg. I am talking something like this, is it? So, now because this lower portion will be much easier to understand. If I say Ks is much smaller than Hg, Ks is much smaller than Hg, which means Hg, Hg can cancel and you get Vy is Ks Ct y by n. So what is it limiting? Ks. Ks is related to what quantity? Temperature, e to the power minus e by kt. So if you can make the process in which Ks is much smaller than h, then the reaction will be governed, the deposition will be governed by only temperature. Is that rest remaining constant? Only temperature. But if I make a case in which Hg is smaller than Ks, then the process will be Vy Hg Cty by n. Hg is decided by what we call as mass transfer. On what basis, what is the equivalent it can be? In a figure which I have shown you, there is a boundary layer and reactant is diffusing through. So what will be roughly Hg value? D by delta is essentially called mass transfer coefficient Hg, diffusivity divided by delta, the boundary layer thickness. Okay. So what are the two equations I am trying to say? By adjusting whichever parameter you wish, you can either make a process of deposition which is function only of temperatures or which is a function of the available mass. Mass transfer. LPCVD uses the first case in which Hg is much larger than Ks. APCVD uses the second case in which Hg is much smaller than Ks, and therefore Hg, its mass transfer limited means wafer has to be then kept flat, because then only it can create a boundary layer and reactant can go. In the case of LPCVD, it is only a function of temperature. So how wafers can be kept? Even like this, as long as their temperature is known, I know how much growth it will have, deposits. So now, is that point clear what I said in LPCVD? Their throughputs are very high because they are only temperature dependent processes. All APCVDs are mass transfer limited process. So wafers have to be kept flat. And then their throughput is less because susceptor cannot have hundreds of wafers. Of course, that belt system does improve the throughput, but still it is limited by the amount it will take, how much belt you can have. You cannot have, of course, belt is right now 14 feet. Okay. Normally, Intel has a process which has 14 feet belt, which holds around 12 inch wafers, around 12, all that said. Okay. So 12 wafers at a time belt pe aata hai. Whole chamber mein entry hota hai. So there is a retention time, you can see on the monitor what's happening. It will say end, wafers will come out, new wafers will start coming. So if you, of course, unless you join Intel, Portland or Oregon elsewhere, you will never be able to see the real life process. Try joining TSMC. But in TSMC also, if you go, I don't know how many will go, but someday if you go, you will be restricted to some 100 feet by 100 feet area. You cannot go other groups. Okay. So tomorrow we will start with, tomorrow means Friday, we will discuss more about the each process and do EP growths, okay, and then finish the this and start etching later.